Good morning. We want to welcome you to River Lawn. I'm Pastor Chris. There's several things we want to mention to you this morning. We're celebrating this morning, May 30th. This is the first Sunday where we are back in our sanctuary for worship in well over a year. I think it's been over 14 months. So we are rejoicing. We are celebrating. We are giving thanks to God. Now, you may not be with us this morning since you're participating virtually with us, but we want to invite you to future weeks to join us for our times of fellowship and worship in the sanctuary. We're going to be observing our health and safety guidelines that's been established, and we just hope you can join us as we thank God and rejoice in what He has done and is doing as He sustains and renews and provides new opportunities and blessings. So let's give Him the praise. Also, want to mention this is Memorial Day weekend. So, in the midst of this extended weekend where we can be thankful for those precious opportunities, for those get-togethers with friends and family, for maybe a cookout or other activities that you have planned, let's not forget to never forget why we have this privilege and why this time is set apart, and to use that time that's set apart to remember those who served, those who sacrificed, those who laid down life for the freedoms, the privileges that we enjoy. May we not take that for granted. And so please, please take time to do that, whether it is as an individual, as you reflect and as you give thanks, whether it's as a family, an opportunity for you to pray together, or perhaps you know a family, or you can reach out to those who are in the midst of this, a family who've lost a loved one in active service. So perhaps there's a way that you can offer a small blessing to them, to reach out to them, even to thank them for the sacrifice that they've made and try to encourage them in the midst of their difficulty, and that we can be praying for those. I pray in this time we're also praying for those families who still remember and still endure that loss. Also, want to point out that this is Trinity Sunday. And so on Trinity Sunday, some of the times of the church are kind of overlooked, not really emphasized, not even known about. And the Sunday after Pentecost, the Sunday after we remember the outpouring and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we've been emphasizing Christ's death and resurrection and ascension and the Holy Spirit. Appropriately, we emphasize the reality that we worship one God in three persons. And so today we're going to marvel at that, the mystery and the majesty of our triune God. And we're going to continue to actually look at Acts chapter 2 and the power of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, and today how we can live into His purpose and carry out His work. So let us, as we come before our triune God, let us worship and let us pray. Would you pray with me? Triune God, what an exciting mystery we celebrate today, that You, our God, are three persons in one being. Your essence is so awesome. It is beyond our understanding. Oh, Father, You adopted us as Your children through the death and resurrection of Your Son. Holy Spirit, You gave us faith in Jesus through the explosive power of the gospel. You testify that we are God's children, and You guarantee our inheritance of eternal glory with Jesus. O Holy Trinity, Your saving love overwhelms us. Keep us as Your own and move us to declare, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." We ask this in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with You and the Holy Spirit, one God, through all eternity. Amen and amen. As we enter into worship, let's be preparing our hearts. Pam has prepared our prelude, which is also Trinitarian. Come, Thou Almighty King. Let us worship. Thank you. As we continue, would you join me in a time of prayer and of confession? Let's pray together. Holy and triune God, you and you alone are perfect and live in perfect relationship, perfect unity, one God and three persons. And you've called us to live in you. Yet we confess that our relationships are fractured and that we are incomplete without you. We are selfish and greedy. We are anxious and resenting. We feel the shame of our foolish behavior and brokenness. We have allowed sin to drive us apart from one another, our idolatry to drive us apart from you. Forgive us and restore us. Draw us close and bind us together in your mercy. May we long for wholeness and peace. May we strive toward gratitude and grace. And in the saving name of your Son, Jesus Christ, by the transforming power of your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Friends, how much does God love us? Enough to send his Son to die for us. Enough to send his Spirit to live in us. Enough to run after rebels, bear our sin, and then call us his own. We are children of the Father. We are the redeemed of Christ. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. It is not by our speaking or by our doing, but by God's good and precious grace that we are saved. This is the good news of the gospel. Thanks be to God. Amen and amen. So, church, let us stand in awe and wonder of our triune God as we sing together, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Now let's turn to God's Word together. We come to, again, Acts chapter 2, and we're diving deeper this week. We're going to look at quite a bit of the chapter. So before we begin, I just want to encourage you to try to gain that attention, that focus, and to pray unto the Lord that He opens our minds and gives us that focus and direction of heart, and that we will not only hear but also to respond. So let us hear the word of the Lord. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, 'What does this mean?' Some, however, made fun of them and said, 'They've had too much wine.' Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd, 'Fellow Jews and all you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. It is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, 'I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life, and you will fill me with joy in your presence.' Fellow Israelites, I can tell you with confidence that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet.' Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this: God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Lord, we pray that you move in us as you moved in those first men and women gathered together by the power of your Spirit, that we will be in awe and that we will respond for your purpose and your glory. We pray this in the name of our Savior. Amen. In 1966, Herb Kelleher, John Parker, and Roland King met in San Antonio's St. Anthony's Club to talk about the need of an air carrier in Texas. Now, the idea was simple, to connect Dallas, Houston, and San Antonio. And the result is the most profitable airline in aviation history. But their cause was really the real genius, to make air travel affordable for people who would otherwise be unable to fly. And this is the reason why Southwest Airlines came into being. So why do I mention that? Why is that significant? Because think about the church. God's people should be even more passionate about fulfilling His purpose for our lives and for His church. But we are distracted, aren't we? We are distracted by every other priority that this world can manufacture and has manufactured over the millennia. It is this typical pattern of fallen human beings like you and me to seek God's help with our agendas, our hopes, our dreams, our goals. But this is the thing, God will honor and empower only that which accomplishes His purpose, because His purpose is the one that is best for us and the one that brings Him the most glory. This is the call. He will honor and empower only that. And so the first Christians learned this, that God's power is intended to fulfill God's purpose and no other. So this morning, let's learn to experience that same power as we fulfill that same purpose. And as we look at this passage, we're going to see five things pop out in all these verses. The first one is this: seize the opportunity at hand. We see this in verses 5 through 12. Immediately upon experiencing the empowering of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit coming upon the disciples at Pentecost, these first Christians found themselves in one of the most exciting ministry opportunities described anywhere in Scripture. You see, the temptation is just to focus on that amazing phenomenon, that unexplainable outpouring of God's power, those flaming tongues and that violent wind, right? What did it accomplish? Okay, think about the disciples in this moment. Jews from all over the empire had gathered each year in Jerusalem for the festival of Pentecost. So the disciples were face to face with people from different people groups from over 15 different countries. They've all gathered together. The people are listed in verses 8 through 11. They span the known world from Rome to the west, to the Parthian Empire to the east. And the first Christians, they would have had to spend years upon years traveling to speak to the same people who are now gathered at their doorstep. They haven't even had that time to prepare where they're going to go next. They're simply told to stay in Jerusalem. They had no idea what was about to happen, how the nations would be gathered, and how God had set the stage. And so, making things even more convenient, the crowd came together because they heard the sound of the Spirit's movement upon the disciples. And each one of them heard their own language being spoken. The Holy Spirit's work. See, when we think we have to do it all, and how are we going to do it in our own strength and energy? I face this every day. I'm always tempted to do that. We can't forget that the Holy Spirit is working and setting the stage. The work of the Spirit created an event through which the Spirit could work. Let's wonder and just be in awe of that. Charles Finney, the 19th century revivalist, was right. When the church is on fire, people will come from miles around to watch it burn, to burn with passion and purpose, just as they had come from miles and miles, many, many miles, to this place, having no clue what they would encounter. And so the gathering crowds, they're shocked. They knew these disciples to be Galileans, but now these country folk, never known for educational interests, had somehow learned the native dialects of each of the people gathered from across the known world. And the crowd's astonishment knew no bounds. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. And so they wondered to each other, what does this mean? But here's the thing, and I never really thought about this before. This is interesting. Each of the groups listed would have known Aramaic, which was native to Palestine. And Greek was also a common language understood across the known world as well. So think about this. Nowhere else do we find Paul or other missionaries unable to communicate God's word because of language barriers, for the Aramaic and Greek they spoke were universally useful. These were common languages. And so think about this. The language miracle of Pentecost did not simply serve to make communication happen. No, it reaches much, much farther and deeper than that. No, this was a work of the Spirit which made possible and made clear the miraculous nature of the gospel. That's why it happened. The disciples could suddenly speak the native dialects of the people, and that endeared themselves instantly to their audiences. It would be very endearing. When you hear these people speaking your language, it's endearing. And so they could build immediate emotional bridges to the hearts of those they sought to win for Christ. And they could demonstrate even more the ability beyond the human, showing that this was the divine nature of their message. It wasn't simply from them. So in this way, the Spirit-filled disciples began to fulfill the commission to be Christ's witnesses in the part of Jerusalem which they found themselves. This was what Christ had told them to do, and he had indeed given them everything they needed and more to accomplish it. So what about us? You and I will always know someone who needs to know Jesus. If we think about it, and we're paying attention, right? There is a neighbor, a coworker, a friend, a family member who represents our first mission field, all right? There is that person. Charles Spurgeon was once preaching on personal evangelism. Again, this was centuries ago, and we need reminded of it today. We've kind of lost sight of it. We've kind of become too comfortable, and we don't talk about it. And I wonder even less maybe be doing it. So Charles Spurgeon was preaching on personal evangelism, the responsibility of the ministry, the priesthood of all believers, your and my responsibility, our call to personal evangelism. And afterward, a fireman told Spurgeon that he didn't even know where to begin. And so Spurgeon asked the man, well, you're a fireman, right? Is your captain a believer? And the fireman said, I don't think so. Spurgeon says, that's where you begin. Begin today with him. Seize the opportunity at hand. What's the opportunity that you have? Where will you begin this day and this week? Okay? Seize those opportunities. Second, verses 12 through 41, we see all kinds of reactions. So we need to anticipate the reactions. Human nature, this is the thing, because it's fallen human nature. Human nature does not change, at least not on its own, without the work of the Spirit. Human nature does not change, making the Word of God enduringly relevant throughout all time. It's enduringly relevant. And this fact also enables us to predict typical responses to the Word. You know, it may take on different faces through the centuries and the cultures, you know, but there's still this reality, these responses to the word. The first crowds to hear the gospel from the disciples demonstrated the same kind of reactions that you and I can expect from those with whom we share the good news today. Here's four different ways they can respond. First, some will be confused. Verse 12, perplexed, they asked, "What does this mean?" Perplexed. You know, a vast majority of Americans think that a Christian is someone who believes in God and who strives to be good. I'm not surprised that that's often what people think, but that's not the definition of a Christian. That's not the definition of a disciple of Jesus Christ. And this is it, though. I don't know a single individual who has come to understand the fullness of the Christian gospel and who have chosen to reject it. If they've understood the power and beauty and grace of it, they haven't rejected it. Typically, our friends and neighbors refuse a pseudo-gospel, a message that convinces them that Christianity is about joining a church, practicing a religion, a list of do's and don'ts. That's not Christianity. That's not the faith. So when we share the actual definition of a Christian, of a disciple of Jesus, of the power of the gospel, many will be confused because it will be different and will need help in understanding the difference. Okay? So some will be confused. Others will be critical. Verse 13, some made fun of them and said, "Oh, they've had too much wine." Again, the festival of Pentecost, it was a festival. It involved feasting and wine. Though the Jews would have not broken their fast until later that morning. So if they were accusing them of being drunk on wine, saying, "Hey, you're supposed to be fasting now, what's going on?" So some of the critics assumed that this strange speech was because the Galileans had become intoxicated by spirits rather than by the Spirit. They were under the influence, just a very different influence, the influence of the Spirit of God. See, people will always be down on whatever they're not up on. That you and I can expect some to criticize our faith and message, to conclude, to reject, to rename, to assume what it's something else. Some will be critical. Also, some will be convicted. We see in verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" They're convicted. The Spirit alone can bring about the conviction of sin and transformation of heart. It is the work of the Spirit of God. That's called regeneration. It's called conviction. He's the one who changes us. And so when we speak as the Holy Spirit directs us, He will use our words in the hearts of those who are open to that truth. Now, you and I, we may never see such a response. We may, but we may not see it. Maybe not immediately, maybe some down the road, but it's always real in that soul because it's the work of the Spirit of God. So some are convicted, and finally, some are converted. Verse 41, those who accepted His message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Man, can you fathom that in that day? And so of those who are convicted of sin and of their need of forgiveness, many will respond by embracing the gospel we share. And then the Holy Spirit who uses us will bring them into our faith family, and they will join us in God's kingdom work. They will also be about that purpose with us. So many of us, this is the thing. I don't know how often you think about your life and the evangelistic dimensions of it, sharing the gospel, how often you talk about evangelism, or if you're living it or just, you know, it's part of you. But when we talk about evangelism, as we approach it, we often approach it as though if we were on trial, right? The person to whom we speak is the prosecutor, and we're trying to defend ourselves against their antagonism. But that's not how it works. When in fact, Jesus is the one on trial. The Holy Spirit is the defense attorney. Satan is the prosecutor. And the person with whom we speak is the jury. A witness is a person called to the stand to share what they have experienced personally. We're the witness, right? And the verdict is not up to you. It's not up to me. You may be the last witness in the courtroom, and you may learn how the jury decides. You may be the first witness called, and you never know how the case ends. You may be somewhere in between, but it does not matter. Your job is simply to tell what you know to be true, what you've experienced, what you know. The healed blind man is one of my favorite witnesses in Scripture. What does he say when he's interrogated and questioned about this Jesus? He says, hey, one thing I know. I was blind, and now I see. That's, you know, amazing grace. It's true for us as well, right? So we need to anticipate those reactions. Third, build a bridge to Christ. Build a bridge. Use this opportunity. In the power of the Spirit, it is your task and mine simply to share what we know of Christ with those that we meet. And you may ask, but where do I begin? Just like that fireman, right? Where do we begin? With what they already know. That's where we begin. Jesus met the woman at the well, and so he asks for water. He found a man born blind, so he grants his sight. He fed the crowds. Why? Because they were hungry. Paul quoted the Greek philosophers when he spoke to Greek philosophers. He quoted the Old Testament when he spoke in the Jewish synagogues. Start with common ground. Find a place where you share a context or experience and begin there. In the case of Acts 2, Peter knew that his crowd was composed of observant Jews, passionate enough about their faith to travel great distances to take part in Pentecost. These are devout Jews, pilgrims from around the known world. And so he began with the scriptures that they would all know and accept. He quoted Joel's great promise that when the Messiah came and the last days began, the Spirit will fall upon all people. And so this Pentecost, coming of the Spirit Pentecost, was proof that Jesus of Nazareth really is the Messiah of God. That Joel's prediction and the Spirit's outpouring legitimized the message and ministry of Jesus' disciples and made clear its divine origin, right? It just legitimized it. It proved it without a shadow of doubt. And then Peter turns from the promise that we see in Joel to its fulfillment. And he explains clearly what Jesus had accomplished with his life and death and resurrection. And Peter stakes everything on the resurrection, for it alone proves Jesus' divinity. And then he quotes David's prophetic Psalms as proof of that the risen Jesus has fulfilled the word of God. He says, this is what David was talking about with this conclusion in verse 36. Let all Israel be assured of this. This is the sum of it. God has made this Jesus whom you've crucified both Lord and Messiah. So we hear all of Peter's message and we think, well, that's great for that audience. We're so glad that that worked out for them. He had that advantage of the Holy Spirit just pouring out in miraculous, profound ways. But this is the thing. Peter's method can be reproduced by any of us who are willing. We can take these similar steps. So first, find a spiritual truth you share in common with the person you're seeking to reach. Perhaps it's a mutual appreciation for the beauty of nature. I certainly love God's creation. Maybe you do too. Maybe it's the grandeur of the cosmos. Maybe it's a shared frustration over the evils and injustices that are found in our society and world. Perhaps you have felt a similar kind of hurt or pain or struggle or loss that this person is now facing. So find a place where you and this person share a similar understanding or experience. Then explain how Jesus has met that, how he has touched that need or experience in your life. If you're speaking with a person in grief, share how Jesus helped you through a time of loss. If you're hiking in the woods with a friend, show how the order of creation and the grandeur and the glory of creation demonstrates an ordered and glorious Creator, and share a way that Jesus has brought order into your life out of the chaos. Share that. People may disagree with your beliefs, but they're going to have a hard time denying your experience, and most likely they're going to be interested in your story. And then present the essential facts of Jesus' life and work. This is what Peter does, that despite what we may think, countless people today still do not understand what Jesus did and why he did it. We need to be able to communicate those essentials. And then use the resurrection to demonstrate Jesus' uniqueness and divinity. Okay? This is all part of it. The New Testament writers, as well as ancient Roman and Jewish historians who did not believe, who were not Christians, they still agree Jesus of Nazareth was a real person. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He was placed in a tomb. On the third day, that tomb was empty. His followers staked their life on the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. And we can learn all those facts without even opening a New Testament, that we see it in early documents of history. But history has yet to provide a convincing explanation for the empty tomb except for the miracle of Easter. So use that resurrection to show the glory of Jesus. And then finally, invite the person to meet the risen Lord personally. It's not just about facts and consent and understanding. It's about encountering, right? Always remember, always keep at the forefront that when it comes to sharing the truth and the power of the gospel, it's not about winning an argument or persuading a person to see things the way you do. I can be tempted to do that. We maybe just, we're so passionate and convicted, but then we don't realize that it's become about needing to be right. That's not what it's about, is it? No, it's about encountering the risen Christ and the newness of life that is found in Him. So if we take all the other steps, if we meet people where they are, if we address their felt needs as Jesus did, but we stop short of offering them what only the gospel of Christ can offer, then we forsake that which is of eternal significance. We need to extend the glory of Christ so they can experience the glory of Christ, and to be forever changed. Next, fourth, and this kind of flows right out of what we were just saying, encourage others to personal faith. Invite them to encounter the personal Christ. Now, encourage them to personal faith. Verses 37 through 41. This is the wonderful news. We may think, you know, I've been living up my faith, and I haven't seen many people come to Christ in my life, and you may feel discouraged, and you may think you're not good at this, or that you're a failure. Guess what? Again, it's not about us. It's about being open and responsive to the opportunities given to us and trusting in the Spirit to work. Because some will always respond to God's Word as it is made clear by God's Spirit at work. And when those people do respond, we are to speak the call of repentance and faith. Again, today that may not be a popular thing to do. We tend to shy away from that word repentance. What are they going to think of us? Doesn't really matter what they think of us, does it? We're still called to this call. Peter called the people, and we're called as a people to forsake false gods for the one true God, to turn from the pursuit of the world to the pursuit of Christ, to trust no longer in ourselves, but only and always in the Savior. That's what repentance is. It is a turning from one thing to another. It's a turning from sin to the Savior. You know, a common response to the gospel, a very common response, this kind of goes back to what we were saying about, well, a Christian is someone who believes in God and strives to be good. Well, often people see the gospel as they trade, though, faith for works. They replace faith with works. That as long as I'm a good person and believe in God, that's what counts. I've got three questions for you in that one statement. Counts for what? And how good? And which God? There's a lot you can question in that one statement. And while some may believe that they are good enough for God, there are others of us who believe that we'll never be good enough, that we're trapped and bound and desperate and hopeless. But you see, both of these kinds of thinking, I'm good enough for God, I'm never going to be good enough for God, both these kinds of thinking are based on good works or the lack thereof. We must encourage each one to come to the same grace offered by the same Father, because that's the gospel. And so Peter's commitment to the gospel was personal and passionate as he pled with the crowds to come to Christ. And the result of Peter's proclamation and the disciples' Spirit-filled witness was stunningly historic. Some 3,000 came into the faith that day, and the most powerful spiritual movement in human history had begun. John Claypool is right. Only that which happens to us can happen through us. So we need to be praying. We need to be praying for the Spirit to work in our lives. And then when it comes to it happening through us, we need to know it doesn't just happen through our words. Our words are important. Sometimes we say talk is cheap. That's only actions. It's not one or the other. It's both. When others see what Jesus means to us, when we live out His love and service and sacrifice with His humility and integrity, they will be drawn to Him as well. It is attractive. It is magnetic. It is infectious. So such living, coupled with our words of witness, connects heart to heart and moves the soul to faith, all by the wondrous work of the Holy Spirit. All by His work. We see it all through Acts 2, all through the book of Acts, all through the New Testament, all through the Scriptures, all through history, all through our lives. And then finally, we not only want to invite them to faith, we want to invite them to family. Invite others to join the family. Verses 42 through 47. The gospel is not only for the person, it is for all of humanity. Every image of the Christian faith found in Scripture is a collective picture. A body with many members, a vine with many branches. I'm not going to dive into the argument of whether or not you should go to church. I think it's kind of obvious what my answer would be, but here's this emphasis again and again through Scripture. It is a collective picture. The Spirit's work turned enemies of God into children of God and then empowered them to live as a unified, reconciled family of God for the purpose of God, and still does. But He works through us as a body, not as cadavers. And so their priorities should be our priorities. Together, Bible study and prayer and fellowship and worship. Because out of these priorities came a community of faith which would withstand every persecution across 20 centuries. And like those first Christians, we witness God's miraculous power as we do the same things. Four things we see in the last verses. As we pray and minister together, verse 43. As we share life and needs together, verse 44 and 45. As we worship with glad and sincere hearts together, verse 46. And as we give thanks to the God who continues to add to our number those who are being saved, 47. And don't have a small vision of what that means. Adding to our number those who are being saved. Because too often we think about filling our pews. That's not what it means. It means the Spirit of God working through the body of Christ around this world with the gospel and bringing people into the family of God through the redeeming work of Jesus Christ. Adding to that number, advancing that kingdom. You and I, we live in a world of increasing fragmentation. More and more and more, it seems that we pull into our isolated lives. It's true with more and more with every passing generation. What do? You know, most cannot name the people who live on either side of their homes or apartments anymore. They don't know their neighbors. We're not in Mayberry anymore. We're not. Some of you may not even know what that is as I'm preaching, but I'm guessing a lot of you do. But God made our hearts to need each other. That's the design. We cannot be joy-filled alone. The body of Christ provides the one entity that our virtual culture cannot. A genuine family, birthed by the Spirit of the living God. Nothing that can't be duplicated or replaced or be given an alternative in this world. It can only be done by the Spirit of God. And so God's mission for His people is clear. He will empower us to the degree that we will fulfill His mission. Is that our desire? Do you sense His Spirit at work in your life today? Is that the desire of your heart? Do you want it to be? And if so, would you pray with me now? Let's pray. Lord, we come before You, and Lord, we pray that Your Spirit will move in us and through us for Your purpose, just as Your Spirit did the millennia ago through those disciples. Lord, to advance that kingdom, to enlarge your family, to share the glory of the gospel, to share the wonder of our Savior, and that you will continue to change us, and that we will give you the glory. Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Make us new. Revive us again. Send us out that we may be about your work and seize every opportunity. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We have another opportunity to do that now as we come to a time of giving back to the Lord through our tithes and offerings, knowing that it goes to fulfill that kingdom work. It's part of that ministry. It's an extension of the body of Christ. So we want to thank all those who have continued to support the work, mission, and ministry of the church as you send in your gifts. And this is a time where we can set aside our hearts and our giving, our living, dedicating that unto the Lord. And as this time of preparation, Pam Mullins will be singing for us. And this is true for us. It is our prayer. Lord, I need thee every hour. Let's continue to worship.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need. Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Teach me thy word and thy rich promises. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me, thou my Savior. I come to
thank you, Pam. As the Lord has given, as we've had opportunity to give, let us go again to the Lord in prayer. We come to a time to dedicate those gifts unto the Lord and also to pray for the people and those in need. We continue to see a world that is fractured. We see a world filled with chaos and violence and loss and unexplainableness. Lord, we pray that as we come together, our hearts will not only go out, but His Spirit will move in us so that we can be those agents of redemption and those agents of justice in this world, that He show us and empower us give us courage and humility to respond. So let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we worship you as the creator and sustainer. Lord Jesus, we worship you, Lord and Savior of the world. Holy Spirit, we worship you, sanctifier of God's people. Heavenly Father, we pray that we may live in your presence and please you more and more. Lord Jesus, we pray that we will take up our cross this day and follow you. Holy Spirit, we pray that you will fill us with yourself and cause your fruit to ripen in our lives. Triune God, power behind all we see, grace beyond all we know, love before all we meet. We cannot comprehend your majesty. We only know your presence in our lives. It seems too good to be true that you would care for us, that despite all our failures, you would choose to mold us again more and more into your image. And so may we also see your image in those around us and respond as your hands and feet. Pour your mercy into our hearts and souls, giving us eyes to see and ears to hear your presence at work in every person, every place, every moment. Lord, may we remember, may we be grateful for those who lay down their lives for others. We remember what our Lord Jesus says, greater love has no one than this, than the one who lays down his life, her life, for another. Lord, we pray that we will be those who remember and are thankful, but also we pray for the families and those who grieve, who still struggle with unimaginable loss, that you will come to sustain and strengthen, that you will use us to bring your hope and healing. And where we need that, that you will bring your body, your family, our brothers and sisters to our door. Lord, we pray for your Spirit to work. And may our words and actions bring praise to your name, reaching out into your kingdom, made real for us in the person of Jesus, who has taught us so much, including how to pray. And so we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Now hear this blessing. We have gathered for worship. Now we scatter to serve. Go out to share the story of life with the world around you. Share Christ in speech and in action. And as you go out to give a living witness, testifying to God's love at work in the world, go knowing that the triune God goes with you. Go. May God the Father, creator of the world, Jesus the Son, given for the world, and the Holy Spirit, ever present in the world, be always with you, that you may know the fullness of our holy God. Go in peace to love and serve your Lord. Thank you for worshiping with us. We hope to see you again soon. May the Lord bless and keep you. Amen.